We have seen the concepts of what is process, thread, task. Now here mainly we have to deal with multitasking of the process, that is we have to have some algorithms for scheduling. And so first section we will see about what is context switching. You all are already familiar with what is context switching from the last previous classes. So we have to understand that in a multitasking environment, there is a provision, that is the ability of any operating system to hold multiple processes into the memory and switch the processor, that is a CPU, from executing one process to another process, that is a multitasking. Now multitasking means it is going to involve all these processes, that is context switching, context saving, context retrieval, etc. So first let's see once more what is context switching and then proceed to the scheduling algorithms. So again, recollect what were the important points of context switching. That here the switching indicates switching from one process to another process. So the current process which is it is being executed has to be saved. So all the data pertaining to that process has to be saved. So one context is saved and then another context is taken up. And now the new process runs. That means the new context has been switched. And during the switching process, no useful work is taking place. That is basically the system is going to remain in idle state. So it is purely a overhead process. And the context switch times, they are highly dependent upon the hardware used also. And the speed can vary from machine to machine depending upon the memory speed, registers to be copied and existence of special instructions. Now refer to this figure. This shows a timeline diagram. That is, it is going to switch from one process to another process. So this explains the concept of what is context switching. And the different colors here indicates the idle state and the running state. So first of all, the system is executing the process one, that is, it is in a running state. Meanwhile, the process two, it is coming and interrupting the system. So there has to be a context switching. So delay in execution of process two happened due to context switching. That is, immediately it doesn't proceed to execute the process two. There will be a delay time during which the system is going to remain in the idle state. So in that context switching time, what are the process occur? It has to save the current context into the process control block. That is, we are having two process control blocks here. That is process control block 0 and process control block 1. So it has to save the current context into the process control block 0 and then perform the other operations related to context switching and then reload the context for the second process, that is for the process 2 from process control block 1. So in this example, I have used two processes, that is process 1, process 2 and two process control block with respect to process 1 and process 2, that is process control block 0 and process control block 1. Now once the context switching has occurred, the process 2 will be in the running state. Again, what will happen, it has to switch back after completing the process 2. Again, it is switching back from process 2 to process 1. So again, also in this state, you can find that process 1 is not running, it is in the idle state. So there again, context retrieval process has to take place. That is, it has to save the current context into process control block 1. Then it has to reload, perform other operation and reload the context for process 1 from process control block 0. So it has to retrieve it. So here context switching, context retrieval, etc. is taking place. Now once again the switching back take place, process 1 again starts running. So all these terms are always present, or all these processes are always taking place in a multitasking environment. So each and every task has got its own context, and the context continuously updates during the running of a task. So in a multitasking system, continuously all these activities occur, that is context switching, context saving, retrieval, etc. And in case of a single CPU and multiple tasks, all of the tasks will be awaiting the service from the CPU, and one task should not monopolize the use of CPU. So CPU has to be shared between the tasks. So to create a feel of parallelism, each task is getting executed but not at all at the same time. So this sort of parallelism, it is achieved by multitasking. So now we will proceed to the scheduling algorithms which is employed in this multitasking environment. Now, the scheduling algorithms is divided based upon the types of multitasking, mainly upon the preemptive multitasking and non-preemptive multitasking. That is mainly how the system is going to deal with the multiple interrupts. Now, the first basic primitive form of multitasking is a cooperative multitasking, that is in which there is a mercy of the task for each other for getting the CPU time for execution. So it is in which a task or a process, it gets a chance to execute only when the current task voluntarily relinquishes the CPU. And in this, a task or process can hold the CPU as much time as it wants. So it is just a very primitive way of describing a multitasking. That is, as long as a process want to use a system, it will use it, and next process will be getting a chance only by a mutual cooperative form of multitasking. Now, mainly we have to discuss about the type of preemptive multitasking and non-preemptive multitasking. That is, if multiple interrupts, they are going to occur in a system, how the system is going to deal with it, either in a nested or a non-nested manner. That is, either in a preemptible or non-preemptible mode. So, in case of preemptive multitasking, we can say that in case of a preemptive multitasking, the process, it will be taken away from the processor. That is, in case if a timeout is occurring or if a new interrupt with a higher priority is occurring, that particular process which is just being executed, it will be stopped and the new process will be taking place. Okay, so that is preemptive. So in between, routine diversion is allowed, and when and how much time a process gets implementing, that will be based upon the scheduling. So every task in this case will be getting a chance to execute. Then in the case of non-preemptive, in between routine diversion is not allowed. That is, whatever process it is being currently executing, after completing that only it can proceed to the higher priority interrupt or to another task. Okay, so it is allowed to execute until it terminates or enters the blocked or wait state. That is, we have seen about the different states of process. So either in the case that one process is completing or if the process has gone to a blocked state, then only another process can be carried out. So in such a cases, maybe some tasks may not be getting a chance to execute. Whereas in the case of preemptive, it ensures that all the tasks may get a chance to execute. So we need to have an operating system scheduler for sharing of the resource between the different process. And when a number of tasks is arriving, the scheduler, it has got the duty of allocating the services of the CPU to each one of them based on a set of scheduling conditions. And these conditions depend upon the type of application for which the operating system is used. So it will be application specific and determined which process is to be executed in a given point of time. That is scheduling. We can define the task scheduling process as determining which process is to be executed in a particular given point of time. The selection of the scheduling algorithm or the criteria can depend upon these following factors. First one is CPU utilization. That is, percentage of the time the CPU will be allocated to the process. If it is being allocated the full time, its utilization is 100%. Response time means how much easily it gets its response. So that depends. So the scheduling policy adopted for the system, in that case, it is assumed to be good if it gets its response soon. Next is the turnaround time. That is, at what time the process is asking for a request to the time the process enters its exit state. So that total time is called as turnaround time. So it is a sum total of execution time or the wait or the block periods. And the throughput rate correspond to how many number of tasks is processed in a unit time. And it will be the inverse of the average turnaround time. So these are some of the criteria for determining which scheduling algorithm or criteria to choose in an application specific system. So in the case of a scheduling algorithm for the preemptive mode of operation, that is the preemptive means that the process it will be stopped. That is, an in-between routine diversion will be occurring in the following condition, that is for a timeout or arrival of a interrupt with higher priority. So these are the algorithm which works on preemptive scheduling. We will discuss each of these in detail. And next, in the case of non-preemptive, that is the system itself does not allow for in-between routine diversion, but the process will be taken away from the processor in either of these conditions. That is, it has finished its normal operation, it has entered its exit state or completion, and it requires some input-output device, that is input-output event occurs, or it executes a system call. Only in these cases. But it will not be stopped if a high priority interrupt occurs. Now, algorithm which work on the non-preemptive scheduling is given. So we can see each of them in detail. Now, before going to the scheduling algorithms, just have a look between the differences of preemptive scheduling and non-preemptive scheduling. So the first difference, it states based upon its working principle. That is, in case of the preemptive scheduling, the resources will be allocated only for a limited time. But in case of non-preemptive, once the process is completed, till that much time it can hold all the resources. That is, in this case, in case of non-preemptive, in between routine diversion is not allowed, whereas in the case of preemptive, it can be interrupted in between. So starvation in both the cases also going to be different. That is, in case of preemptive, that is, if there is a high priority interrupts frequently which is coming, the low priority process is going to starve. Whereas in the case of non-preemptive, if a process is having a longer burst time, so that is go on to execute, then other processes are only going to starve. There is a basic difference between the operation of preemptive and non-preemptive. And in the case of overhead, so in case of preemptive scheduling, since it allows these diversions, it has got much overhead, which is not present in non-preemptive. And this is a flexible approach where you can process all the operation based on priority, but non-preemptive is a rigid approach. And there is no cost associated with non-preemptive scheduling, but there is cost associated with preemptive scheduling. Now we'll proceed to the algorithms. One type of the non-preemptive scheduling method is cooperative scheduling, or it can be called as first come first serve scheduling or first in first out scheme. So what does it mean? It is there in the name itself. That is, there is a cooperation between the tasks. So while one task is executing, the another must be willing to wait. So that is why this name is called also as a cooperative scheduling. So it is a simpler, there is a process that requests a CPU first is allocated the CPU first. So whoever comes first gets the resources and implemented with the FIFO queue. And when a process enters the ready queue, its process control block, it would be always inserted at the tail of the queue. And when the CPU is free, it is allocated with the process at the head of the queue. Then the running process is then removed. That is, once it is execution, it is removed from the queue. Now see this example. Suppose if there are three processes, okay, process P1, P2 and P3, and they are arriving at this particular order itself. So at what order the process comes, that is important. Okay, suppose for in this example, I have assumed that the order in which the processes are arriving, that is the request is arriving, is in the order P1, then P2 and then P3. And these values are the burst time for completing each of these process. So first case, the process P1 has to finish its execution, then only the P2 can start. So how much time should P2 wait? The P2, it has to wait for a time period of 24 milliseconds. So since the unit is in millisecond, P2 has to wait for a time period of 24 milliseconds. Then how much time should P3 has to wait? P3 has to wait until P2 also completes. So P3 has to first of all wait till P1 complete, then P2 has to complete, then only P3 can start its execution. So P3 has to wait for a time period of this 24 plus 3, that is 27 milliseconds. So what is the average wait time? The average wait time will be, for P1 it will be 0. So since it is first being requested, it gets executed without any waiting time period. So it is 0. P2 waits for 24 and P3 waits for 27 milliseconds. So likewise, we can calculate the average value. So the total divided by 3, since there are 3 processes. Then what will be the average turnaround time? That is, turnaround time, we know it is a time taken when a process is initially requesting a CPU, and the time to which it finally exits after execution of the process. So in the first case P1, the turnaround time is 24. In the second case, it is 24 plus 3. That is, it will complete only after time period of this 24 plus 3. And P3, again, it will be this 27 plus 3. That is the turnaround time for the process P3. So the average turnaround time can be computed as such. So 27 milliseconds is obtained. So all of this depends upon the order in which the processes arrive. Suppose you assume that it is in a different order. That is, first of all, process P2 come, then process P3 and P1. It is coming in a different order. Then all these values, they are going to change. So who comes first, that is being processed first. That is the basic principle of this type of scheduling technique. So we'll come to the next type of non-preemptive scheduling method, that is the shortest job next or the shortest job first algorithm. So it is there in the name itself. Which process can be executed more faster? So which is having a short burst time? The CPU will process it first and then give the chance for the other process. So tasks are being queued in the order of increasing service time, and one with the shortest time gets to execute first. But the problem here is that most of the cases, the execution time for each of the tasks are not known in advance, and then the service time will be estimated by using the history of each of the tasks. So this is an example for the algorithm. That is, we assume that the process which is having the shortest burst time would be given the first chance for execution. See this particular example. We have considered here four different processes. So all these are certain tasks to be performed, and it takes the particular service time periods. So which one is having a shortest burst time, which can be executed more faster, that will be scheduled first. So in our case, we can see that process P4 is having its shortest burst time. So P4 gets a chance first, followed by process P1, then process P3 because it is having 7, and process P2. So which is having a shorter burst time, in that particular order the scheduling is being carried out. Now this type of representation, you have to understand that this is a form of Gantt chart. So in Gantt chart, we will be having the x-axis to be the time and the y-axis representing the activities completed. So the activities completed in the time period will be indicated with the help of such a Gantt chart. So in our case, the x-axis is representing time. Suppose process P4 is executed first, because in this algorithm, one which is having shortest burst time is given the first chance of execution. So P4 can be executed, for example, with 3 seconds, then process P1 with 6 seconds. So totally, it is getting extended to 9 seconds. And by the time it finishes process P2, that is, after execution of P4, P1 and P3, there is a total time period elapsed of 24 seconds. So likewise, we can show our representation with the help of a Gantt chart. So we have already seen the scheduling methods of the non-preemptive mode, that is a first come first served and the shortest job first technique of scheduling. Next, in the case of preemptive, so already a running task is being pushed out from the running state to the ready state, and then another task is taken up by the CPU. That is the concept of preemptive scheduling. So there are two scheduling methods of the preemptive mode. First one is round robin scheduling. It is also called as a time slice or time sharing technique. So we are going to define certain time slices or time period. For example, if there are n tasks, each of them is allowed to execute for a period equal to this time slice. After this, the next task has to get its turn. But it can also use a CPU only for a time equal to the defined time slice. Thus, all the tasks get their chance at least once in a round. So what is the advantage? It takes care that every of the tasks, it gets a chance for execution, at least for a time period equal to the time slice. So let us see an example to understand what is round robin scheduling. For example, assume that there are three processes, okay, P1, P2 and P3, and it is arriving in this particular order. it is a request is arriving. Now we have defined a particular time slice or time quantum, say to be 4 milliseconds. This will be defined based upon certain criteria. Now by the round robin strategy, we have to take care that every of the process should get a chance for execution at least for a time period equal to the time slice. So process P1, the total burst time for the process P1 is 24 milliseconds, but it will be allowed to execute at least for the period of this time slice. That is, process P1 is executed for a time period of say 4 milliseconds. Then process P2 should get its chance. But process P2, you can find the total time needed for execution of P2 is only 3 milliseconds, which is lesser than this time quantum value. So process P2 is being completed in this process. Then process P3 also, you can find out, it takes the same time as that of process P2, and it is also less than the time slice. So process P3 also completes its execution. Now once process P2 and process P3 has completed its execution, then process P1 will be again further executing because it has not completed its execution earlier. So now process P1 now will be going again from the ready state to running state, and it will run until the execution is being completed. So here all of the process, you have to understand that it has to get a chance first in the initial round at least for a time period equal to this time slice value which is being set. So this is an example of round robin. This is a Gantt chart representation. That is, in the x-axis we have shown the time period for completing, and the y-axis what all activities process is taking place in those defined time periods. So as you can see, P1 completes only for 4 milliseconds in this case. Then after P2 and P3 only, the remaining time means again it will take a time period of 20 milliseconds. As you can see from the chart, 20 milliseconds to complete its whole execution. So next type of preemptive scheduling method is the shortest remaining time, or it is another form of the shortest job next. That is, we are going to compare the process in terms of the service required to complete that particular process. That is, since it is in a preemptive mode, suppose if a task is being executed and if a new task is arriving or a high priority interrupt is arriving, its service time will be compared with the service time of the currently executing task. And if the new task has got a shorter service time than the running time of the current task, then what happened? The current task is preempted. Okay, it is replaced with the new one. That is, it is being allowed to preempt, and the new one will be serviced until it is complete. So let us have an example of this type of SRT, that is shortest remaining time. So let us have a look upon the shortest remaining time scheduling algorithm. So here we have considered four process P0, P1, P2, P3, and we have to consider the arrival time also. Since it is a preemptible mode of scheduling, we have to consider about the arrival time, and it is a total burst time and its units is in millisecond. Now first and foremost, even during the working condition itself, first the process P2 is coming with the request, and that time the CPU allocates its resources to the process of P2 because there is no other process in the queue. Now, while process P2 is being executed, process P3 comes up with the request, and it is coming at a time period of say 1 millisecond. So how does the scheduling algorithm work? It has to find out whether the total time period required for process P3, it is greater or small than the remaining time required for process P2 to complete, and then take a decision. So currently P2 is being executed. So what is the remaining time required for process P2? It is 5 milliseconds, because already 1 millisecond has elapsed. The remaining time required for process P2 to complete is 5 milliseconds, which is larger than the time period required for process P3. So process P3 can be completed faster. So now CPU allocates the resources to process P3. So currently process P3 again will be executed. Now while P3 is executing, the process P1 is going to arrive at time period of 2. So now we have to find out What is the remaining time required for process P3 and what is the total time period of P1, and then take a decision. So now the remaining time required for P3, that is only 3 milliseconds. It is lesser than the time required for the process P1, which is 4 milliseconds. So process P3 will be allowed to continue. Again, when it is continuing, process P0, as you can see, it is arriving with the time period of 3. So now the remaining time required for process P3 again have to be found out, which is only 2 milliseconds. But that is almost equal with the process of P0. That is, P0 also requires 2 milliseconds. So first and foremost, the system will allow process P3 to finish its execution. Okay, so P3 will continue, and after P3 terminates only, the CPU will be allocated to the process, say P0, as it has got less burst time than the other. So first and foremost, P2 was being executed. It is being preempted by the process P3. But when we are pertaining to the SRT algorithm, the process P3 is allowed to continue until it finishes. Then you can observe that in the Gantt chart, process P0 is given a chance. Why? Because it has got less burst time when compared to the other. Then after P0 terminate only, the CPU is then being allocated to process P1 and process P2 depending upon the burst time. So here we have to consider the arrival time and the burst time also. So this is a Gantt chart representation. That is, initially P2 was executing. It is preempted by process P3. The process while it is executing, the other process, that is process P1, P2 also comes into picture. But based upon this SRT technique, the CPU decides to continue the process P3 itself. Then based upon the burst time, the process, other types of process are given chance. So this is an example for the shortest remaining time algorithm. Now, priority scheduling algorithm can come under both preemptive and non-preemptive mode. So the difference here is written here. That is, in case of preemptive, always the newly arrived process priority will be compared with the existing priority, and if it is higher, then the current process will be preempted. And in case of non-preemptive, newly arrived process is put at the head of the priority queue. That is, it is non-preemptible. That is, there cannot be diversion. But however, there will be a priority register which is going to maintain this queue. That is, as soon as the current task is completed, then it can check for the priority and take up another task. So the priorities can be based upon the many factors is given, like internal priorities, external priorities. So the task priorities will be numbered, for example, like 0 to 255, 0 representing the highest priority and higher number indicating the lower priorities. So process having the highest priority would be scheduled for the execution first. So again, you can see these are the process, the burst time required, and the priority numbers which is being assigned. So this is a Gantt chart representation which shows that the process are being scheduled on based upon their priority. So the first priority is for process P2, followed by P5, then process P1, then process P3, and then for process P4. So the drawback is that in heavily loaded system, continuous stream of high priority process will keep the low priority process from getting access to the CPU. So this is a priority technique which can be actually stated in both the preemptive and the non-preemptive mode also. So in this section, I have explained about the concepts of context switching. So how there can be a scheduler to schedule and make the multitasking process in a better manner. So based on the non-preemptive and the preemptive mode, we have seen about how the scheduling is being done.